the New Testament, the Gospel according to Matthew. Matthew, the third chapter, beginning at the 13th verse, a very familiar text. When you have it, say amen.
Amen.
Then Jesus came from Galilee to John at the Jordan to be baptized by him. And John tried to prevent him, saying, I need to be baptized by you. And are you coming to me? But Jesus answered and said to him, permit it to be so now. For thus it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he allowed him. When he had been baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened to him. And he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting upon him. And suddenly a voice came from heaven, saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. For a focus for you, the last verse once again, verse 17. And suddenly a voice came from heaven, saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. A topic for your consideration, oh, to be more pleasing to God. My brothers and sisters, let me just cut to the chase. We are living in a self-centered, selfish, self-serving society. Social media outlets have allowed time to stand still and every moment to be moralized with an infamous selfie. I myself am guilty of having 1,393 friends on Facebook and over 5,000 pictures. I love me some me. I love the me that God created me to be, but I also love the one who created me, the Amen. Lord. Through the years, I have found myself wanting to be a people pleaser and please man. But about 5 years ago, I came into the knowledge that I can't please all of the people all of the time. And since I understand who makes me and in whose image I am created, I want to be more pleasing to God. When looking at this particular text, I am reminded of the song that the saints used to say, only what you do for Christ will last. So if we want to have everlasting life, we have to do what it takes to make it last. Many of us are going through an identity crisis or in situations right now where we don't know who or whose we are because we have taken our eyes and our mind off of God. We are focused too much on ourselves or a problem or the people around us. However, our focus should be to please the one who keeps us in perfect peace. He alone is the author and finisher of our faith, creating us with a divine purpose in mind. The backdrop for our text is very familiar and simply the baptism of Jesus. John the Baptist has declared that Jesus is coming, and though Jesus is walking in his purpose and calling, he understands his role in preparing the way of the Lord, who will do more than just baptize with water, for Jesus is the baptism. As we fast forward to the end of the text, we are privileged to get a glimpse into the collision of the Trinity, and that God the Spirit descends upon Jesus the Son. And then we get to hear the conversation between God the Father and God the Son, in which he declares, this is my Son in whom I'm well pleased. Oh, to hear the voice of God say that he is pleased with the work that we do for him. Those of us, and most of us I can see, were around in the mid-90s, and we're familiar with the name Michael Jordan. Michael Jordan is said to be the GOAT, or the greatest of all time. He is the epitome of athleticism, not just in basketball, but in all sports. He is the standard by which many athletes attest to want to be like.
Amen.
In the 90s, everybody wanted to be like Mike.
Amen.
Amen.
Well, here we are in the year 2017, and we are still plagued with that same problem. Everybody wants to be like somebody, but nobody wants to be like Jesus.
Amen.
We want to look like Kim Kardashian, sing like Beyonce, dance like Usher, or ball like LeBron. We want to have the dream job of being Mary Jane, the wardrobe of Crooked Lions. Come on, don't act like y'all don't watch Fox up in here. And a myriad of other characters. But no one wants to be clothed in righteousness, dance like David, work like Ruth, or be like Christ. For to be like Christ is to be pleasing to God. We are familiar with the character of Christ. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. All of that good stuff that we also know to be known as the fruits of the Spirit. We have all experienced Christ in his perfect divine being, his perfect piety or his will, his intuitive perception of the best and highest. Christ calls it like he sees it, not dressing up our sin with fancy names like shacking up and all this new stuff we like to call fornication. His excellency as our guide, in all things leaning not to our own understanding and acknowledging him in all our ways. Our omniscient God knows it all. His knowledge of the divine and of the future. The old folks say you got to know what you know, what you know. God's sovereignty and divinity are not up to debate, and quite frankly, he doesn't need our defense. His profound knowledge of the human heart. Jesus does not look on the outside, and he's not concerned with brother and sister so-and-so are wearing. He looks at us through a spiritual lens, my God. His absolute impartiality. Jesus is just and fair. We are all equal in the sight of God. Even as filthy rags, he can use us from the pulpit to the pew. His rigorous righteousness. Jesus is constantly working out our soul salvation. But are you? His faithfulness. If we want to be pleasing to God, you can't give up and you can't give in. The saying used to be, when the going get tough, the tough get going. But when the going get tough, you better call on the name of Jesus. He can make a way out of no way. Now, though we may have the character and characteristics of Christ, we must activate and operate in them to be pleasing to God. God, Jesus gives us the perfect example of how to do this in this text. First of all, when Jesus came on the scene, John was already doing the work of the Lord. But Jesus was not in competition with John the Baptist or anyone else for that matter. See, Jesus had 12 boys that ran with him. They were his gang, his ace boom coon. They were down like four flat tires. They went back like Cadillacs. But Jesus knew who Jesus was. And even though he knew who he was and what his purpose was, he was supportive of the ones who prepared the way for him and surrounded him. The goal is to bring them in, let Jesus clean them up, and we work together in our respective roles for the purpose of his glory. You can't do what I do. I can't do what you do. And even though we may have similar assignments, God gives each one of us in our own special way. My story is not your story. My testimony is not your testimony. My witness is not your witness. So therefore, the glory I give to him is not the glory you give to him.
Amen.
You all are aware I am a preacher. My father is a preacher. I had an aunt and an uncle that were preachers. They prepared and laid a foundation on which I stand today. But I assure you, I don't preach Jonathan Baker's sermons.
Amen.
I can't do it like he does it. But then again, he can't do it like I do it.
Amen.
I operate in my gift and he operates in his.
Yeah.
We both serve a purpose in the kingdom. And get this, Jesus knew and understood that John served a purpose in fulfilling Jesus' purpose and the prophecy that he would be born, die, and resurrected for our sins. Understand that all the people that God allows to cross our path serve a purpose, even when they may cause us pain. If it had not been for Judas, there wouldn't be a Jesus. Amen. If it had not been for a Pontius Pilate, there would not be a Jesus. If it had not been for Barabbas, there would not be a Jesus. Jesus knew he had to go to John for his water baptism, but not for himself, but Jesus, who is the fire baptism, had to baptize the water. There are times when God will send you to a person or a place that you just will not understand. You will be in the midst of the situation and you will say, my God, why have thou forsaken me? My God, forgive them, for they know not what they do. But be like Jesus and not like Jonah and just go. If God sends you, he is already there waiting for you. Amen. You don't always have to be the head of every ministry. Sometimes your role is to be the help. Be obedient and supportive of the work of the kingdom of which you are privileged to serve. Be more pleasing to God.
Amen.
Next, to be pleasing to God, we have to die to self. We are all important to God, but ain't none of us that important. It ain't all about you. The work will get done with or without you. Any of us die today or tomorrow, the church will still stand. In verse 15, John questions Jesus about him being the one to baptize Jesus. Once again, Jesus understands John's dilemma. We have to know that Jesus understands and knows all about our struggles.
Amen.
But what Jesus did is he was patient and he took the time to explain to John how he fit into the purpose and prophecy fulfillment of Christ's life.
All right, come on.
John, like many of us, really don't understand the role we play in kingdom work. Some of us live for years without knowing our purpose. Before Jesus came along, John was the man to see for the water baptism. But in this life, in this world, if you're going to do the work of the kingdom, you're going to need to be baptized with more than water. You're going to need the fire baptism of the Holy Spirit. Jesus could have very easily done the work without the symbolic water baptism. After all, he is the fire baptism. But he knew that John needed him to be obedient to God and fulfill his part in John's purpose, just as much as Jesus needed John to fulfill his part in Jesus' purpose.
Man.
Do not be a hindrance to the work of the Lord.
Yes.
Do the work or get out of the way. Let me say that again. I know I ain't gonna get no amens, but that's all right. This is a good sermon right here. Do the work or get out of the way. Stop asking all these questions. Finding all these faults. Doing all this complaining. Just put your hand to the plow and do the work. Be more pleasing to God. My brothers and sisters, many who read this text do so in the context of the symbolism of the water baptism of Jesus Christ. And it is just that, a symbol. The true baptism happens when the glory of the Holy Spirit falls on you. The Holy Spirit makes preaching easy. The Holy Spirit makes singing easy. The Holy Spirit makes working easy. The Holy Spirit makes living easy. You've got to be born again, fire baptized, Holy Ghost filled to be pleasing to God. As soon as Jesus was baptized, watch this, he was tempted in the wilderness. We will all have a wilderness experience. If you have not experienced your wilderness yet, keep living and walking with the Lord. In the wilderness, you're going to need the Holy Spirit. That's how I know I've got it, because I've been in the wilderness. Some of us are in the wilderness right now, trying to figure out how we're going to make it out. But I'm here to tell you that when you're filled with the Holy Spirit, you know that everything's going to be all right. True serving of God cannot be done until you've got the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit has you. The Holy Spirit lifts up Jesus. The Holy Spirit convicts and corrects us in Jesus. The Holy Spirit renews us in Jesus. The Holy Spirit gives us life in Jesus. Oh, y'all are excited about the Holy Spirit. It's okay, because the Holy Spirit
in Jesus. The Holy Spirit compels us to worship and empowers us to witness about Jesus. The Holy Spirit is the life we need to live a life centered, anchored, and around Jesus to be more pleasing to God. Lastly, to be more pleasing to God, we've got to serve. The songwriter says it best, a charge to keep I have, a God to glorify, a never ever dying soul to save, and fit for the sky, to serve the present age, my calling to fulfill, oh may it all my powers engage, to do my master's will. Jesus was a servant. He made the ultimate sacrifice in the service of his life. He came to give his life to do his Father's will. Everybody wants to lead, but nobody wants to serve.
Yeah.
I don't preach for the applause or the amen. I serve the Lord. We don't sing for show. We serve the Lord. We don't worship for our own gratification. We serve and give glory to the Lord. For many of us, if it had not been for the Lord on our side, where would we be? I'm on the battlefield for my Lord, and I promise him that I will serve him till I die. I'm on the battlefield for my Lord. Everything we do should be in service to the Lord. Not just on Sunday, but on Monday. Not just on Sunday, but on Tuesday. Not just on Sunday, but on Wednesday. Not just on Sunday, but on Thursday. Not just on Sunday, but on Friday. Not just on Sunday, but on Saturday. Every day, everything, with everybody should be in service to the Lord. We are to serve God, and in order to serve God, you've got to serve God's people. So often in church, we hear this infamous line, I don't do that, or that's not my job. But if you don't do it, who will? If it's not your job, whose job is it? If you want to lead, you've got to be willing to serve. If you are about kingdom business, you need to make it your business to serve. To be pleasing to God, we must be willing to follow the example of Christ and unselfishly serve. Today, we often recognize our military as those who serve our country and sacrifice our life for freedom. But my word tells me, he who the Son sets free is free indeed. So I'd like to take this moment to thank the ultimate no-limit soldier. When I look back over my life and think where he brought me from, my soul cries out, hallelujah, hallelujah, and thank you, Lord, for saving me. There is no limit to his love. There is no limit to his salvation. There is no limit to his service. One day, on a hill far away, on an old rugged cross, they hung him high and they stretched him wide. He hung his head, and for me he died. The tear so deep, the sun would not shine, but he gave his life for yours and mine. I ain't worried about what people say. My God got me on the third day. They put him in a borrowed tomb.